Thank you for tuning in to the Comeback Podcast. Allow me to introduce our esteemed cultural historian and president of Stony Brook University, Dr. Maurie McInnis. Dr. McInnis is our sixth president and came to us from the University of Texas in Austin. She has served in pretty much every academic role from professor of art history to vice provost at the University of Virginia to provost and executive vice president or vice provost at University of Texas, Austin, making her eminently qualified to run this A1 research university in Stony Brook, New York. Welcome, President McInnis.
I'm very glad to be here. Thanks for having me.
So my first question is, how did you do it? I mean, we've been through some time here.
Yeah, it was quite a year, wasn't it, for all of us?
Mm-hmm. So you came in right the height of it.
Yeah, pretty much. So I was originally offered the position in early March, and that was before any of us had gone remote. We were all talking about COVID, right? But none of us, I think, had any idea how much it was going to upend our lives for the next year. So after my appointment was announced at the end of March, I immediately began being involved with the planning for the next year, although I did not officially begin as president until July 1. And what I entered into was a campus community that had been working so hard to care for the many thousands of patients on Long Island who were in that initial wave of COVID-19 infections. And what I could see was an amazing team working together here to uphold multiple missions at once, to figure out how to care for these many thousands of patients, but also what to do about all of our students and how to care for our international students who and others who needed to remain on campus and didn't have a home that they could return to, how to turn all of our courses overnight into remote instruction, which happened very quickly and, you know, relatively seamlessly, and how to support our students through what was going to be a very difficult learning experience. And planning teams came together, and that's how we continued working as we were trying to plan for the fall. You know, as we got to late spring, it was very obvious by then that it was not going to be what I think many of us had imagined initially, is that, oh yeah, we'll all go home for 2 weeks, or we'll go home for a month or something like that. And it was clear this was going to be with us much longer. And so we had on campus extensive planning teams filled with faculty and staff who were gathering information, working with our healthcare experts to try to understand what was the thing we could do to best provide for the needs of our campus community while also keeping everyone healthy and safe. And, you know, we did it. I mean, I think Stony Brook has so much to be proud of. We, yes, did very careful planning. That said, sure, we were all still nervous. What if we haven't made the right choices? What if we aren't able to keep the community healthy and safe? And I think there was a number of really key decisions that we made that really led to a successful semester. You know, the first was that of the students who were going to be resident here, we asked each of them to come with a negative PCR test. And then we began surveillance testing of our residential students, our commuter students, and then added our faculty and staff. And we also had a campus community that understood the importance of following the important guidelines of always being masked and staying physically distant from one another. And it worked. There were some positive cases, definitely, but we were able to quickly put them into isolation and quarantine their close contacts. And our student affairs team did such an amazing job of caring for those students in the time that they had to spend in the dorms, which I know is very difficult. Our faculty did a great job, both of their in-person as well as their remote teaching. And the campus community just really came together in support of one another. And then, starting in December, we were able to start getting vaccines into everybody's arm. And we have vaccinated over 500,000 Long Islanders, including offering many, many thousands of shots to our own campus community. And so it's really been a great collective team effort.
That team effort, you mentioned your team a lot, and I want to just quickly highlight that because in unity there's strength, right? We can't do it all alone. And I had the pleasure of meeting Dr. Paul Goldbart, who is the new provost, and he's in physics, right?
Correct.
You are in art. So can you talk a little bit about that merge and the importance of connecting science and art?
Yeah, absolutely. And thank you so much for that question. So, you know, one of the great things about Stony Brook University is that we span so many different disciplines. That's what makes a great research university. And universities are made up of both individuals who have incredible depth in their particular area, as well as individuals who are thinking not only deeply in their own discipline, but how does their discipline connect to other disciplines? What is the sort of intellectual energy that flies when you put people from different disciplines together, thinking often about a similar large question or topic? And that's the great strength of Stony Brook University and the great strength of building up your academic leadership with individuals who come from different disciplinary perspectives. So I emerge from the arts and humanities. That's been my training and most of my education. And Paul Goldbart, a renowned physicist, you know, his training mostly in the natural sciences. And the great strength of a university like ours is that we not only have all of this, but they talk to each other and they work with one another. And we figure out ways to tackle big problems by bringing people together across disciplines. And it's often the spark of creativity that emerges when you have people sitting around a table grappling with a big question, but who might come at it with one particular disciplinary lens. And then you have multiple disciplinary lenses, and suddenly the sparks begin to fly and the creativity emerges in those moments.
So tackling those problems, that's, I think, been the goal of this past year and a half. And I'm curious, you are an art historian, and based on history, and I asked this question to you back in Grit 2020 when I hosted a podcast with you, how can we learn from history and the past and what we tackled with this pandemic and then apply it forward thinking to the new semester?
Yeah, great question. And I do think that we really do ourselves a disservice if we do not take moments to reflect on big decisions, big challenges, big obstacles, and to think about what went right and what went wrong. And we should do that not just in failure, when we're pretty used to doing that. Oh, that didn't work. Why didn't that work? But we also need to do it when things go well, because there are things that we are going to learn that worked well, and we want to be able to replicate those. And aspects, even if you get it right, there may be parts of your process that didn't work as well as you might want them to. And I would say that, you know, we learned so many things last year, but if I take it up to a higher level, I would say that the biggest learning is the importance of bringing a lot of voices together to grapple with a difficult challenge facing us. So whether it was the very large teams we had that were involved with our COVID planning, and those met weekly throughout the year, and in fact, they're still ongoing, right? So this is a process that has worked well for us. Lots of different committees filled with lots of different voices that, you know, noodle on smaller issues, and those then flow upwards, you know, to bigger committees making bigger decisions, as well as the other process that we put in place last year that also involved a lot of our campus community, the strategic budget initiative. And, you know, in addition to the challenges of COVID around health and safety, we also had a huge budgetary challenge facing us. At the time, the beginning of last academic year, New York State was imagining that they were about $15 billion in the hole. And so they were imagining they were going to need to give very large cuts to higher education. And so we knew as a campus community that we needed to begin working together very quickly, not just to solve the immediate challenge of this year, but to plan for what was likely to be a major reduction going forward. And so we put together the strategic budget initiative with five task forces involving over 250 faculty and staff, asking the questions, how can we operate more efficiently? Where are places we can save money? And where are places that we can generate new revenue? And what are we doing to get in our own way? In other words, what do we need to, how do we need to work together better? So that we can innovate and so that we can make progress towards the future. And so the big learning, if we're going to look back to our very recent history, the big learning that I think is important for our future is the power of bringing so many bright minds together to help solve a problem. You end up with better solutions. Because you've thrown a lot of creativity at the table, you throw a lot of things against the wall, you see what sticks, and you just get such better solutions when you're working together as a team, inclusively building a future together.
And I think that's what's so beautiful about Stony Brook students. They're from all around the world. So we get all of these brilliant minds in one place, and it's a powerhouse.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think one of, you know, we know that your generation is going to face a world very different, even from the one that I grew up in, a much more interconnected and global world where no matter where you're working, whether it is in the United States or elsewhere in the world, your team members, the people with whom you're going to be working, are going to be from everywhere. And the questions that you are going to be facing are going to be either very local but have global components or be very global. And one of the best things that we can do to help prepare students for that kind of future, for this very interconnected world, is to have a globalized campus like the one we have, where we not only encourage our students to take advantage of international opportunities, whether it's study abroad or an internship overseas, but we also have a global community here so that even if you don't have the opportunity to study abroad, you do have an opportunity to get to know people from around the world, to develop that deeper understanding of different cultures, of different perspectives, and how to work in diverse teams, because that's your future.
Even though everyone is so diverse, and this is speaking on behalf of students now, as a student myself, even though everyone is so diverse and from different areas, we're all kind of in the same boat. And FOMO is a real thing, fear of missing out. And I feel, at least me, in this past year, it's not really a fear of missing out, it's just this feeling of missing out. So I want to highlight that for a moment because there are so many students who graduated in 2020, graduated in 2021, or, you know, going to graduate, and they've missed out. So can we talk about that for a minute?
Absolutely. So I am a parent, and my children are 21 and 17. So I've had the very up close and personal view of that, exactly what you are talking about, that feeling of missing out, as well as hearing it from our Stony Brook students. And it's true. You all did. And I think it's important that we acknowledge that over the last year, while yes, we can feel really great about the future, we need to give space to acknowledge and mourn that which was missed. And that actually in some ways can't be replaced because for I think both, you know, children and for young adults, there are these kind of markers of events that take place at certain stages in your life. And if you go back and try to do them 3 or 4 years later,
it's lost its thrill.
Exactly. It's just not the same thing,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
You know, and y'all aren't going to be able to get those back. And that's a sad thing. And we should give space to acknowledge that, because we want to respect those feelings and to be very honest about them. And that is then going to have to exist alongside. I mean, that's y'all's reality.
Yeah.
And it will shape you all. It will shape your generation. We just don't yet know how. Because they're also, you know, I don't know that skills are the right word, but there are ways in which you as a generation have grown through experiencing this event together, figuring out how to be adaptable and how to still make things work and make new things work and create new things and new ways of bonding and new ways of being together that are likely going to be with you all. And they have definitely shaped who your generation is. I just don't think we can yet know the full ways in which that will also have some probably flowering aspects as well.
I guess it's just a matter of looking at the glass half full instead of half empty. I mean, so much horrific things have happened, right? And we can't just invalidate those. But looking forward, right? And in the fall, I feel that it's going to be revitalized. This campus is going to be just booming with energy. So many students back and realizing that they can't take it for granted. Because even though they didn't want to go to that lecture and they wanted to stay back in their dorm in their pajamas and watch, you know, binge watch Netflix and eat popcorn, it's really, you know, it's really a blessing to be here. So how can we look at that? Just the appreciation of it all.
Yeah, I couldn't agree with you more. I really hope and feel very optimistic that that is indeed the energy that is going to greet us this fall. I know I feel that way.
Me too.
I cannot wait to have campus full. It has seemed so empty over the last number of months, although as spring was rolling around and more people were vaccinated and we could be outdoors, more and more people gathered and we had events and we had commencement. We had 10 beautiful commencement ceremonies.
Wonderful,
right? Where
yeah.
We were able to give every student who wanted to do it the opportunity to walk across the stage, have their name called, have their family watching in the stand. It was really, really great that we were able to do that. And I got some sense of that energy of Stony Brook's great students. And I've certainly gotten it across Zoom from many, many different groups that I've met with, but I can't wait to be able to do it in person. And I do hope that as difficult as last year was, that it gives us the opportunity, exactly as you said, to reflect on how important and special this community is, how much it means to each and every one of us, and that we will come back to the campus really ready to reaffirm our commitment to this community, to our values, to our mission, to Stony Brook University. And we certainly, as we're planning for the fall, are trying to think about a lot of events that we can give people those opportunities to come together and really celebrate being Sea Wolves.
And you must be excited for that, right?
I am. I'm finally going to get to meet people.
Right? This is the first time since you've been president.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, when I was first offered the position and I was imagining, like, what's it going to be like to, you know, be a president at a new campus where I don't really know anybody? And of course, I imagined the normal course of the way you do those things, right? You meet with a ton of different student groups and you go to big events and you go to small events and you meet with faculty and you go to their department meetings and you go to faculty meetings and you, you know, have speakers and you meet people at receptions and, you know, the list goes on and on. And all of that was predicated on the ways we had always engaged with one another, which was really in-person conversations. That's as human beings, how we most easily get to know people and most easily build our communications. And instead, we had to figure out, okay, how are we going to get to know a campus community when we can't meet anybody? And so, you know, in my first year, we did a ton of Zoom meetings and we did, you know, physically distance outdoor masked meetings in small groups, or, you know, individually outdoor masked one-on-one meetings, or lots of not only email messages, but video messages and Zoom town halls with hundreds of people logged in and, you know, questions being typed in and trying to answer them, and websites with tons of information. I mean, we tried to fill a lot of those gaps, but nothing's the same as being able to meet people. So I just can't wait for this fall and the opportunity to do that.
I can't wait either. Tell me one thing that you're looking forward to. I mean, I know the in-person interaction, but if the fall semester could be perfect, right? Nothing can be perfect. We have to remind ourselves that. But if the fall semester was just ideal, what would it look like to you?
I think what it would look like to me is that, you know, everyone who wants to be living on our campus is able to do so, that our in-person classes are the sort of vibrant intellectual academic spaces that I know everybody wants them to be, and that they have been in the past, and that we learn from what went well last year. And there are ways in which technology enhances what we're doing so that when you come back, your academic experience is even better because of what we've gone through in the last year, that we have more people engaged in on-campus activities, right? Just as you were saying before, that there is a renewed appreciation for what this community means. And so people will come and stay and be involved in more of our kind of annual events, that will also create some new annual events, new traditions that are really all about celebrating us as a community. And I feel confident that we're going to be doing that together.
I am curious, I have to ask you, you were once an undergraduate student, right?
Many years ago, but yes, I was once.
Did you ever imagine that you would be the president of a top university?
Absolutely not. I mean, I can say my whole career never had a plan.
Okay.
And that happens to an awful lot of people, right? You know, and even if you think you have a plan, you often find yourselves deviating from it, because I think opportunities arise along the way that you had maybe never even considered as an opportunity, or that it would be an opportunity that would come your way. So, you know, I didn't even really have a plan to become a faculty member. It just, you know, I loved what I was studying. And so, well, I'll go to graduate school, and, oh, well, I'll get a master's. Oh, I'll get a PhD. Oh, I got a teaching position, right? I mean, it was often not at all planned, but just taking advantage of those really kind of serendipitous opportunities that get put in front of you, and just taking a deep breath and saying, sure, why not? This sounds interesting. And essentially, that's how I ended up here.
So saying yes.
Saying yes. Saying yes to so many things. And not every yes led to where I ended up, except that you grow as a person, you learn new things, you grow in your experiences and your perspective. And I think one of the most important things that we can hopefully unleash in students as they are undergraduates is a sense of curiosity, a desire to embark on a life of learning and a life of growing. And with that, you kind of never really know where you're going to end up, but it's a really fun journey along the way.
I think it's so important that you're a mother, you were an undergrad student, and now you're the president. And so you're not just some robot standing at, you know, on the top tier trying to point. You're involved and you get it. That's what's so important about you as a leader, is that you understand every single person here, whether they be a parent, whether they be a student, whether they be a woman, right? You can relate.
Yeah, thank you for that. I mean, I do think, you know, we inevitably bring our own lived experiences to our roles as leaders. But I think I'll say one other thing. In addition to the curiosity I hope that we will unleash in our students while they are here, I hope we'll also help them learn how to listen. Because while my lived experience gives me some window into the lives of many of this community, there's so many in this community whose lives I've never experienced. And that's where the listening comes in. And that was one of the things, you know, if we go back to what went well this year, by building these broad, inclusive committees to help us plan, that's really all about listening, right? How can a leader or how can a leadership team make good decisions? Well, it's built up by these broad listening campaigns that undergird the recommendations that flow up for decision making. And being curious and listening are two of the most important skills I think you can gain in life.
I agree. There's too many people talking all at once. We need to just be silent. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Can you impart one fun fact about yourself?
Oh, gosh. I'm awful at these sorts of things. One fun fact about myself. I don't know if they're fun at all. You know, most of us as children have something that we're really into, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And when I was growing up, there wasn't much in the way of sports for women. This was really before Title IX had led to the growth in women's sports that we see now. So my sport, if you call it that, was dancing. In addition to that, so I mean, I did all the things that many young people do. So, you know, modern and ballet and jazz. But I also then became involved in what is referred to as Scottish Highland dancing. And it is a sort of dancing that has competitions all over the nation. I'm of Scottish descent, and my family, you know, had always grown up with, you know, the bagpipes and men in kilts.
Oh.
And so I got involved in Scottish Highland dancing and competed nationally in that event until the age of 18.
That's spectacular. I never heard about. Is it kind of like Irish step dancing?
It's similar to Irish step dancing. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
But you were great at it,
yeah.
Sounds.
Yeah. The Scots would make fun of Irish step dancing, right? So they have quite a rivalry, but yes.
Well, I guess competition brings, you know, yes. Goodness, right?
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. McInnis, for coming on to my show. I hope all the students learn something, to be curious, to listen, and to just kind of be positive, right? And not get too wrapped up in all of the negativity.
Yeah. Well, it's been a really tough year. We want to be sure as a campus community that we're doing everything we can to support our students. It's been a tough year for everybody's mental health. It's been a tough year financially. And I hope that we can be there to support our students, that we can come back together strong. We are stronger together.
Mm-hmm.
And that we can all support one another as we look towards the future and build towards a brighter future for everyone.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me. Great talking to you.
Same here. Thank you for listening to The Comeback. I'm Melanie Formosa. Hang in there and keep smiling.